Hi YouTube, and today what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you through a deck that I played it yesterday quite unsuccessfully, I have to say. So there is a big caveat with this with playing with this deck, particularly in the XY to breakthrough format. But having said that, it is a hugely fun deck, and I have been through quite a journey of discovery, I have to say, with this deck. Only discussed it with one other person in the week running up to Cities, and so really gave nothing away, because I just really wanted to try and see how an original deck would fare in the current XY to breakthrough standard format. And the deck that I chose, I have to say, is Groudon, because it just seemed to be really favorable, if not 50-50, with all decks apart from Vespaquin Vileplume, which I expected to see some level of play, seeing as though the weekend before was Reading City Championships, and that deck actually won it. So with Reading, the news came that Entei was everywhere. Totina was second place, I believe. It's definitely featured in the top bracket. You also had Vespaquin Vileplume just suddenly sweeping everything in its pathway. So I initially started testing Vespaquin Vileplume, and then I thought, right, okay, it's really patchy. It is a risk. People do know about it as well. Has a huge frailty with the float stone. So what you'd have to do is reduce the consistency of the deck by playing a grass energy, an AZ, and just something else just to bring it up. And so I was put off with Vespaquin Vileplume, especially with Entei being so popular as well. I just thought, well, actually, you know what? Grass will be subdued. It's worth the risk of running something that could be strong against all of these decks, even though it does have a grass weakness. And who plays Sceptile? There was only one person that played Sceptile, one person that did really well with it at Reading. And by doing well, we mean a positive matchup after, I think, the fifth or the sixth round. So you know, that was bravely played, anticipating Totina, which didn't appear, and I thought, all right, okay, well, it's not going to happen. Just give it a whirl. You know, after the three or four rounds, you're not going to see a Sceptile at all. The Entei's are just going to take over. So anyway, let's just have a quick look at the deck, and I'll take you through in less detail what the attacks actually do, because it's well documented in terms of what Groudon does, and Wubfei as well is the partner with this. But more so, I'm going to go into detail about the choices with the cards themselves. Then what I hope to do in part two is I hope to go through some reformations and changes of what I would suggest anyone taking up the deck itself. So anyway, let's just have a quick look at Groudon and remind ourselves: 180 HP Pokemon. The weakness is there. Yes, it is. Ripclaw. You don't really want to be attacking with Groudon right at the very start. You want to be walling with Wubfei, because Wubfei just silences a lot of decks out there. And I have to say, there are players out there that still don't interpret Wubfei correctly. You know, Wubfei works at shutting down all abilities only when it's active, and all abilities except Psychic. So I have to say, I was playing against one player who will remain anonymous, who was evolving it up to Golbat, and with Wubfei active, they just weren't doing anything. It wasn't even just like, oh, can I do that. It wasn't just like a silent indication. It was literally, I'm just going to evolve Crobat and then just pass. And you know, Crobat is an option, and you know, you've got to really indicate that you're doing something. But if they're just Crobat and then just passing, there's obviously nothing happening there. So for those players, just read the card, make a, you know, make some better decisions. Anyway, that sounds really, really harsh, but Ripclaw 30 could do. You know, if you're at a push, you're going to be Ripclawing. Only if there's a big bunch of energy that you've got in your hand, because then you can start attaching energy, and you'll then be able to have six turns where you'll stream. But what you really want to do is you want to try and get that ground on back to the bench as quickly as possible. Massive Rend. I may have been able to Massive Rend through my opponent's Shrine of Memories, and I did make one mistake in the first round, even though I did win that match, and it was because I forgot about the resistance of Shaman. So I gusted out a Shaman, and it was two prizes. I thought, brilliant, you know, just on my way there, and my opponent pointed out, well, you know, that's not a knockout. So fair enough. That, and I can't quite remember whether Shrine of Memories was in place. I think if Shrine of Memories was in place, I would have just done the stadium knockout. So all right, and I at that stage I couldn't attach strong energy because I just didn't find it. So that I just put down to still getting used to the tournament round one. That's just that was just ordinary. In defense, I have to say, there was one opponent that tried to calculate a knockout on my primal Groudon and forgot Assault Vest, so it was just sitting there with 10 HP left. So, you know, it's easily a deck that kind of wobbles opponents, and it makes you think about all sorts of things while you're trying to do damage calculation, which isn't easy given a City Championship tournament situation. So Massive Rend is there at a push, only if your opponent is playing Shrine of Memories. That's the way that I saw it when I was walking into the tournament. Okay, Primal Groudon. 240 HP. Very few, if any, Pokemon can take it down. One more thing that can now take it down is a Mega Mewtwo EX, because it doesn't affect, it's not affected by weakness, obviously. There's no weakness on this one with Psychic. But you do a 10 base damage, right? Then you do 30, 60, 90, 120. So that's 4 energy on the Mewtwo itself. Then you got 150, 180, 210, 240. So if Primal Groudon is fully powered, all you'll need is 2 energy and a Mega Turbo if you are the Mewtwo player, or a DCE to attach that turn, or you just have one Mega Mewtwo powered up fully all the way. Anyway, you're not going to think about here's another one. You could have 3 energy and Giovanni scheme, so that could be quite devastating to a primal. Now, in defense, there was only one player that was playing Mewtwo in the cities that I went to last weekend, and the same player was playing that this weekend, and that was Luke Kirkham. And there was another player that was playing Mewtwo, and justifiably both of them, I believe, made top 8. So I think that was Tamau. So well done to those two. And great match in round one against Luke, and I drew. So winning the first game, and it went right down to the last card. It went down to Mega Turbo. Luke had to Sycamore to 0 cards with about 30 seconds left in the game. And he managed to get my active Groudon with 180 HP. Now, had I, in hindsight, I could have put that Groudon a turn earlier, taken a KO, and then I had the Primal Groudon in hand as well. And one of the things that I'm just a bit restrictive about at this moment in time is putting down Pokemon as soon as I get them on, get them in my hand, because that actually lost me a game when I played against another great player, Nathan, down in Reading. That was really, really marginal. I wasn't playing Primal Groudon then, I was actually playing Gallade. I'll do another video on that one very soon. And I lost because it was a Lysander and it was a Milk Tank. And again, it was last turn, really, really marginal. So my point being that expect to have really marginal games versus top tier decks. Having said that, when do you not get that? You know, at this moment in time with the metagame, everything is right down to the wire with different deck choices. So yeah, just marginal ones. Gaia Volcano is the one. So if you what's really nice is if you are able to secure a quick 20 on a Mewtwo, you know that is within range for the rest of the game. I did actually manage to, I believe, I might be mistaken there, but I do believe I hit Mega Mewtwo with Energy Short for a bit of damage before being able to, a couple of turns later, do a Gaia Volcano. So Dedenne is in there because I didn't want to spend my first supporter use with Fan Club. Fan Club was an option, Bridget was an option as well. Because what you want to do is you want to try and get more than one Groudon in play. You want to get the Groudon in play, you want to get a tool on there because you don't want Headringer to slow you down one turn, and you also don't want to waste your energy drop. So with all of these factors, it kind of dissuades your choice of what to actually do and what to actually put in the deck. You'd love to just, you know, go through your deck. But this is not like a deck where you play in the same way as you play against as you play a Vespergan Vileplume. You can't just turbo through your deck. It's not like a Night March. It's not like it's something that you just have to be really, really patient with. And so I was facing that. You know, it's not something that you can go online, you can turn online and have within like two turns. It's just not one of those rush decks. However, there's so much comeback ability with Groudon. It can just completely swing the game and just take six prizes within the space of three turns, if it's going your way. So that was the risk that I actually took. So Dedenne, yes. Didn't want to play Fan Club. I wanted to play something that could just pop two Groudon on the bench, and then if they Headringer one, I just start stacking the other one. And it was as simple as that. Retrospectively, could you play AZ in order to bring Groudon back into... But again, you know, what you're doing is you're wasting that energy, that supporter drop, and this is something that I've talked about in previous videos about how the importance of playing that supporter in that first turn. Dedenne was also very good, I think, in anticipating any Yveltal Darkrai. I did play against and lost against an Yveltal Darkrai deck the previous week. Another close game again with Gallade in the first game. In the second game, I ran out of time, couldn't secure the draw. But Dedenne is actually always in the back of my mind for Energy Short. However, Dedenne's purpose in this deck is for Entrainment, and if it does manage to do an Energy Short late in the game, that's just a complete added bonus. It's also a really, really cute Pokemon as well, so I just like having that little Dedenne in there. So I also wanted to make sure that I primed the deck against Totina. I anticipated Totina. Very, very few people in the end played Totina because of this card. But you just can't risk it. And also, I thought maybe you could, you know, given some certain situations with Vespiquen Vileplume, in theory, what you can do is you could try and rip off the float stone of the Vileplume, and then do something in order to bring that active. So floats the Xerosic first turn, second turn Lysander, and bring Jirachi up. And if they try and retreat, they can't retreat. So you're just stardusting, and by that stage you buy yourself maybe 10 or so turns, unless they play the AZ, which is something that I've mentioned previously. So they wouldn't play the AZ really unless it's given this situation, unless people know about the Vespiquen Vileplume. It takes away and detracts from the consistency of the deck. So Jirachi Have to say also, I didn't really use it that many times, but I think it's because of the deck choices that other people made at that stage. But Jirachi is in there. And it's just that constant threat right on the bench, you know, just to buy that turn back that you may need. Wobbuffet, I played three because I had the Dedenne to search for an extra Wobbuffet. In my round two, so round one, I didn't mulligan in both matches, in both games. In round two, I think I mulliganed five times. In the second game, I mulliganed four times. And it put me, well, thereabouts, it put me at a huge disadvantage because in round two, I was facing a Mean Shao Howlucha deck. And the last thing that you want to do, given that situation, is you want to give them extra cards. And literally, I started off with Groudon in both games, and I was facing down a Howlucha Fighting Stadium Strong Energy Muscle Band within two turns. And when that's hitting you for 100 each, you're going down in prizes very, very quickly. And what then happens is you then stack up your Primal Groudon, and by that stage, you're then being hit 80 per turn, if not 100 per turn. So you got your Mind Shower, which is doing Aero Turn for 40 base, Strong Energy is 60, Muscle Band is 80, Fighting Stadium is 100. So you're literally being hit 100 a turn, and you can't touch anything because a Robo Substitute's there. So that was a really enjoyable 50 minutes. Much shorter than 50 minutes, because by round two I was like, okay, this is done and dusted. Bring on round three. The irony was that in round three, I then faced the only Sceptile deck in the room. And at that stage, I thought, do you know what? Just scoop. I'm just out of here. So as soon as my opponent flipped over his Spinarak, I was like, I can't believe this pairing. I can't believe that the tournament software is just completely hating on me. And it was kind of like the end of the journey, because once you have two losses, I don't even want to break even on this one. I just want to call it a day and liquid wound, so to speak. So what I've done in the reformed list is I've added another Wobbuffet. Battle Compressor. Okay, Battle Compressor is really useful, because what happens is you put, and I did test out during testing, I thought, do you discard one energy? Do you discard two? Always, always, always discard two fighting energy regardless. Because when you draw into something else, you're just inevitably going to be drawing into Mega Turbo. Sometimes you draw into two Mega Turbos, and what you want to do is you want to use both of them as quickly as possible. Really tempted to play a fourth Mega Turbo, but I think that would be cloggy in my hand. If I needed to add a bit of extra space, I would raise it to three Battle Compressor, but that would need further testing. In the reform list, I've changed it to two. My initial list had two Battle Compressor, but I made space for other things. Enhanced Hammer, I think situational, really, but it needs to be in there, because what you do is you have Giratina active, and as soon as that Giratina is active, you use that Jirachi and you use the Enhanced Hammer, and they're down to zero energy on their active. And then what I did was I had multiple Silent Labs, so I was able to, and in addition to that, I had Hex Maniac. So again, this was primed to a Totina environment, which just didn't materialize. But hey, that's the risk that you take. So Enhanced Hammer is something that should stay. It's also something that can be found very, very easily with Karina. Now, the initial list had two Escape Rope. I reduced it down to one because I just found that I needed to have my Wobbuffet active, and I needed to choose when to retreat it, more so than actually bring up my opponent's bench Pokemon, so to speak. So it went down to one Escape Rope. Now, Heavy Ball, again, this was trying to get an extra... an extra boost in speed by having Groudon there as quickly as possible. And I justified it by having a searchable option for Primal Groudon as well in the absence of Karina. It effectively acted like a fifth Karina, half a fifth Karina, so to speak. Sometimes one of the things that I did notice about this deck is sometimes you have to dump your first Primal Groudon in favour of Sycamore. So that's something that I do want to maybe put on the back burner. Maybe play one super rod if there was space at all in this deck is something that I would maybe try and recommend to people, especially if you have to get rid of that Jirachi and you need it in that particular matchup. You got 3 Mega Turbo. It's such a good card. You do have your 4 turns, and it would be interesting to see what would happen if I reduced that down to 2 Mega Turbo. But 3 Mega Turbo because it's just so good, and it works with Battle Compressor as well. Professor's Letter. The initial list that I kind of got from a very vague OP Brazilian OP website had 2 Professor's Letter. I cannot understate how important this card is. So in my reformed list, I played 2. I played one in Cities yesterday. Startling Megaphone. Now, this was primarily in for the Entei matchup, because what they do is they just rush. They put setup up there, so if they can see anything, any way of getting set up, what happens is they Lysander and then they set up. They just draw all of their tools and then you're okay to go, because then you can start playing your strong energies. If you get rid of their Assault Vest, it suddenly swings heavily in your favor, especially if you start with Wubbuffet, you don't have to worry about it so much. What happens is they just go through their Sycamores in order to try and get the 2 energy online as quickly as possible, because then what they do is they can then blacksmith and then take out your Wubbuffet. So again, you know, benching tools as quickly as possible, starting in Megaphone is a smart choice. Switch. Okay, right. So I played 2 Switch, and I've changed this in my new list. 2 Switch, you do need a way of bringing back Wubbuffet. But what I found sometimes was that there would be a certain lag. So I would want to retreat something, but not at that point. And so what I needed to do was I needed to have some kind of permanency with the Switch. So this kind of leads to one of my changes that I've suggested. So that was in retrospect is something that needed to be changed. Really tempted to drop down to 3 VS Seeker. If you needed to, you could try that. But VS Seeker is such a crucial card in this deck, because just for that last Lysander up a Shaman option, that is really, really something that you should really keep in mind. It'll just win you games. Fisherman was a last minute choice, and I have to say I only played it once to get 1 basic energy, so it was a wasted spot. Fisherman, why did I play that? Totina. I thought maybe if they just rip off all of your energies. I've seen Fisherman played in another deck, and I thought, well, you know, possibly, you know, it could be an option here, but you know, as bad luck would have it, Fisherman was a dead spot. So it's not needed. Super Rod, maybe, possibly, if you have that space. Hexmaniac, very important to have it in here. Good for Aegislash. Good just to shut down just random powers. This is actually a deck where you do need Hexmaniac every so often. Totina is absolutely essential. So again, yes, you need that Hexmaniac. Would I play 2? Possibly play 2. It would be a good choice. Karina. I kind of wish that I could play 3.5 Karina, because late game you can't find any more fighting Pokemon, which then tempted me to run maybe 1 Howlucha in the deck just to have a free retreater. If I did do the Howlucha, I could drop the Dedenne and just have like the because Dedenne is difficult to retreat, but only for that, and only for getting that extra turn, maybe hitting a Mewtwo with 60 might help. Lysander, another Mewtwo, I don't know, it's possible. But Karina's really, really good just to find that. What I tend to do is find with the 4th Karina, you've got to find a VS Seeker so that you can just get your Lysander. So, you know, it's a card that you have to play one step ahead of yourself. Lysander, you cannot drop this down to below 2. it's such an important card. Now, if you were to drop it down to two, I'd then strongly suggest that you play a town map, which, because you have so many one-offs, might actually be a really good move. But I think with two Lysander, because Lysander is just, it just gets you your prizes. You can, if you've got your stadium in play, every single thing in play is a KO, unless you're up against a Wailord EX. That's the only situation that I can think, and even then all you need to do is just hit it for 10, that's it, and just wait, because literally you're hitting for 200 and you've got three strong energies, so you can even play your strong energies. They can't rip them off, so again, you know, you don't even need to hit them for 10, but if one of the strong energies is prized early, then you've got it. Pokemon Center Lady, really, really good choice. If you're confused, you just get them back. It's as simple as that. If you sustain some early energy, you can then chain Pokemon Center Lady, and they just simply cannot destroy your Groudon in one hit. If they, however, did a psychic type attack like Mewtwo does, it's very difficult to chain that. I'm thinking, obviously, you've got the max potion option, which is coming in the next set. You've got AZ, but again, those destroy your four turns that you've stacked energy. So the only thing that I could suggest would be Cassius. If you play Cassius, that would take your Primal Groudon, any tool, any energy, straight back into the deck. It would replenish your deck. It would give you those extra couple of turns, because sometimes you do tend to deck out with this deck, and if you're not careful. And it would save you your two prizes, but obviously you would have to have those four turns in order to rebuild. So you have your four turns with energy on your active Primal Groudon, and then you spend the further other turns stacking your second Groudon. You would then find that you have maybe typically two energy on there. And if you're quite conservative with your Mega Turbo, you can. Then get your third one and then fourth. So all you really need is two energy on there. So you could get away with one Cassius, but that would be some really brave play. But I chose not to do it. Birch's Observations. Again, you need four cards. In retrospect, I wish that I had a disruption option. So Judge and Ace Trainer. Ace Trainer was in the initial list, and I took it out, and you know, that was my one regret. So my one regret only, because apart from the Sycamore, which was down to three due to the Karina, I had Steven, and Steven served as my second professor's letter, so it was just something that just was, it was just the glue, just the adhesive that kept the deck streaming. Zerosic, you do need that Zerosic for Totina matchup mainly. Now, I was really stuck with the choice of Sailors. I went down to three, and I went down to one Scorched Earth and three Silent Lab. And, you know, I was wavering between two and two Silent Lab. You need that Silent Lab. You need two Silent Lab, definitely. But in an environment where Toad is low, then just play the two Silent Lab, and you can sort of skip around between Scorched Earth and maybe Shrine of Memories as well. The one thing that I found that was a disadvantage of playing Silent Lab was that if I played Silent Lab, my opponent would then be able to use his stage one abilities, and that was something that I didn't really anticipate when I was thinking about Silent Lab. Not that I didn't know about it, but it was purely because I wanted to wall with Wubbuffet a lot, and I would have to play the Silent Lab down in order to play the Sycamore. Assault Vest helped save two prizes in my first round. Because that was just through extra damage calculation that your opponent has to do. So that was a nice addition. But two, maybe not sure, not too sure. I just simply wasn't sure about the third one. I did play Ground Spiraling because I thought, well, why not? You know, you can just have an extra turn. But I did find that you would just have to you would just have the time to stack your energy if the game was working your way. If the game wasn't working your way, it was probably because of the excessive damage that your Groudon was sustaining, or if you were playing someone that you were weak to. So I think I found the one deck that weakness policy belongs in, and it's just before the new set comes out. So drop the Groudon Spirit Link, and obviously once you have your Primal Groudon up, you cannot have any tools attached, obviously, because it only takes one tool, but you cannot have the tool taken off you either, so Xerosic won't work, and it negates and the Omega Barrier also negates Startling Megaphone as well, so you're very, very safe there. The only way to remove a tool would be if you played the Tool Retriever trainer. Now, I went down to 3 strong energy. It was interesting because my when I was playing Luke round 1, to try and get that last strong energy, it actually got to the stage where I didn't find any strong energy until my final Sycamore. And I remember him saying, "Do you actually play strong energy?" And I was like thinking, "No, I don't. Well, I do, but I'm not quite sure where they are." I went down to 3 because of I think Age Slash was a bit scary, but also Enhanced Hammer. It was Totina Fear, so I went down to 3. 3 worked nicely. And I put 8 fighting energy and a nice little cheeky psychic energy in there, just the single one, just in case I needed to do a quick psychic assault. Because if you have Wobbuffet and you just put a fighting energy on there, it's just going to look innocuous. If your opponent is playing Dimension Valley, you could psychic assault, and that could be quite a cheeky little move there. So. Would I play the special psychic energy that allows you to retreat for 2 again? You know, that's a really tough call, because if it's something that can be Enhanced Hammered away, but I think an opponent in retrospect would be reluctant to use up their Enhanced Hammer to take away a special psychic energy on the active Wobbuffet. So maybe it might be a choice to make. Okay, right. So what I'm going to do is in part 2, I'm just going to go through my reformed list, and the reason why I'm running a reformed list is or making those suggestions, because in round 2 I came across a Mean Shao Howlucha deck, which was I think this can't win against Mean Shao Howlucha. This is it's doing 100 in turn 2 and 100 per turn, so you just cannot keep up with the speed of that. So I think that's a complete auto loss. Sceptile with weakness policy, I think you could make a game of it. It wouldn't be as bad a matchup as one would imagine. And in addition to that, if Growlithe has a chance to attack twice on a Vespiquen against a Vileplume Vespiquen deck, you're in with a shout. So I wouldn't say it's favourable against Vespiquen Vileplume. I'd say maybe it's 75-25 in Vespiquen's favour. I think the current build as it stands at this moment in time is it's an auto loss against Sceptile, Ariados. I think there are a couple of changes that might soften the blow, so to speak. But that was my round 3, and then my round 2 was Mean Shao Howlucha, and that was the end of my tournament, really. I was just like, okay, I'm going to go back before it snows. I needed to get back home. So, all right, in part 2, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through the changes, and if I've got enough time on the video, I'll take you through a demonstration game on PTCGO. Okay, see you in a bit. Okay, hi, and welcome back. And this is now the list that I would play, and it is it doesn't look very different really from the offset, but I think it would stand a better chance in the XY to breakthrough format. So again, we start off with a 3-3 line of ground, and I think that's just staple. You just have to take that risk with Subaru. You'd have to be completely unlucky to have two primal Groudons in your hand and the Sycamore. I do remember in my second game versus Luke Kirkham, it was a really, really good match. What I had in my hand was three Sycamore and a startling Megaphone, and I had that within the first three turns of my game, so I had to get rid of a lot of things. And I thought, yeah, that'll be okay, because I hadn't done a search in my deck at that stage. I thought that would be okay, because all I need to do is just VS Seeker anything that I need to bring back. I actually had two VS Seeker prize throughout the whole game. So again, and I only lost that game on the last turn. So again, you know, this would be something that would be a brave choice to play and to take up. And if points weren't on the line, I'd probably run it again. So we start off with 3-3 Primal Groudon. Okay, that's just staple. I would keep the Jirachi. I'd keep the Jirachi just purely because of the Totina matchup. I think that just scares it. Wubbuffet now up to 4 because I need that as a starter. I think I've dropped a Dene because Yveltal has just completely fallen off the map. Two Battle Compressor, because what I want to do is I want to get the two energy and I want to start getting supporters into my discard pile in case I draw into those VS Seekers. So again, it's just a little bit of extra speed, thinning out the deck as well. The Enhanced Hammer stays as well. Escape Rope, because I think it's just such a nice utility card to have in the deck. Heavy Ball, tempted to run two, will just run one. It did drop out, but then I've dropped my Kareen down to 3, and that's a very, very brave move to make. However, what I've also done is I've also put in extra support, so it's not as if I want to try and find Kareena straight away. I do want to find Kareena, but my Heavy Ball acts as my fourth Kareena, so I can now start to introduce other cards in the deck. That extra space makes a difference. Mega Turbo again stays at 3. Professor's Letter now up to 4, so I'm not playing the Steven anymore. So I need to have that energy in hand. Startling Megaphone is staying at the 1. VS Seeker still stays up to 4. Now I've put back in Ace Trainer. And Ace Trainer, because you expect yourself to go behind in prizes, and I think that would probably be a big push in the right direction. Now that does combine really, really nicely with the second Battle Compressor as well. So that would be interesting to see how that runs. Hexmania obviously stays. The Karina's down to 3 now. Lysander 2. Pokemon Center Lady is there as well, so that stays. Birch is staying at 1. Sycamore staying at 3. We've also got Skylar. Introduction of Skylar, just to bring up the extra trainer card. You could actually also bring up a stadium with that, so it's a search for stadiums basically. I wish that Karina could find stadiums. I was just missing that. So that Skylar would be able to suddenly turn you 100 to 200 on Groudon EX, and I think with VS Seeker, I think that's actually a really nice proposed addition. Xerosic stays in there. You've also got Scorched Earth as well. Now my stadium has now changed to Shrine of Memories being one of them, and I've still got this two Silent now, because Totina still would remain a threat, and I don't like adding an extra auto loss to the list. Alright, okay, so Focus Sash is now in there, because if you're going to take a hit from Vespiquen, my other tool is going to help with that. But Mewtwo is now starting to emerge. I think with 4 energy on there, Mewtwo can't afford to attack and just nibble it just for the 1 energy. Just for maybe 30 or 40. You know, it can't afford to take it all the way up to maybe 220 and just sit there, because their Mewtwo is going to be knocked out. So you will always get a KO against an EX of some form, and it allows you to be very aggressive then with your Groudon, your primal Groudon that you have spent so much time energizing. So our focus sash goes back in there. Focus sash was actually something that did was a staple in Primal Groudon decks anyway in the days of Rayquaza. So who knows, Rayquaza could actually start going up in popularity with Mewtwo, but then you suddenly form this little cycle with Night March raising being popular as well. So all right, okay, Floatstone. Okay, right, so it's not a bad idea to pop a Floatstone on a Groudon EX if it's active, because then you bring it back and you save yourself that extra damage. You then save yourself wasting your two energies trying to attach for Ripclaw. Okay, Floatstone is also not a bad idea to put on a Wobbuffet, because once you have a weakness policy attached to a Groudon EX and then you level it up to or Mega Evolve it to Primal Groudon, it's not going anywhere. So are they going to waste their turn of supporter Zerosaking away a Floatstone on an active Wobbuffet? The answer is no. Could they burn their starting Megaphone on a Floatstone on the active? Well, yeah, that could work if that Floatstone was on a Wobbuffet, but then that Wobbuffet's not going anywhere. So it's something that would be to my advantage totally if I attached a Floatstone to an active Wobbuffet, because then what I could do is I can then, if I get something knocked out, I can then have a free retreater. I can retreat and save a prize as well if the Floatstone was there. And I have to play weakness policy now, because I think in the game as it is right now, if you want to stand any chance of winning against Sceptile EX, Focus Sash wouldn't do it, because they would just poison you and the poison would get around the Focus Sash. So weakness policy, and let's say for example they attack, and this is not with Mega Sceptile, this is just with Sceptile, so 70 plus 60 would take it down to 70 plus 60 would be 130 damage, 150 if they play Muscle Bands. My opponent in round 3 didn't see a single Mega Sceptile, and if they ran the Mega Sceptile it would just be 100 and they would be healing, they would be attaching. However, you would then be attacking their Mega Sceptile, you would be knocking out their Mega their Mega Sceptile, especially if you have strong energies to add to your damage as well. So you know, careful use and utility of strong energy would be vital in that matchup. You find your strong energy, you stack them onto your Groudon, you attach your weakness policy on there as well, and you would be able to take 2 Sceptile EX, and that should be enough for the game. And then what you would have is you would have a second Groudon, which then can knock out a Shaman. So you use that second Groudon for that purpose only, and you win out. So I did initially have a Psychic Energy, but I talked myself into playing Mystery Energy in my last video clip. So again, you know, that's if it's Zerosiked away, then that's fine. If it's Enhanced Hammered away, that's okay, because my Wobbuffet is still active. So it's a complete advantage again to play Mystery Energy. The only disadvantage is that you can't attach that to Groudon. However, because I now play 2 Professor's Letter, I'm not going to be stuck with not getting that much energy in play. So, and with all the extra supporters that are in play, it's fine. Again, just playing 3 strong energy, that could be something that you could play about with, maybe 4 strong energy and 7 basic. You could drop the Mystery Energy as well for the 4th strong energy, but you know, that would just be, you know, something to play about with. So there it is, that's my reformed Groudon EX deck, XY to Breakthrough Standard format. And what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to play a typical game with my reformed list, and I'm going to see whether we can see how the deck plays. Okay, thanks for watching so far, and we're going to switch over now to the game. Okay, welcome back, and as it's Bad Deck Monday, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to run a few games with this reformed Groudon list, and we'll see how many games we can complete in the fastest time possible. if it's looking like a complete loss, then we'll just skip to the next game. So we're up against King 8. I love these new Pyral sleeves. They're just amazing. Alright, okay, we got a good start. Inevitably, we'll probably face Night March, Vespaquin, Bronzong, which is just... Oh, it's an Entei! Nice, okay. Should be okay. Jirachi stays on my in my hand. Not liking the choice of cards I've got in my hand. Two Mega Turbos, very unfortunate. Got a Hex Maniac, but at least we get to draw a card and we get the Skyler. Okay, so we're just going to keep it as it is. We're going first. We've got Syndicate. Oh, it should be okay, actually. Let's get the Skyler out. And the great thing about Skyler is we'll be able to get the Karina, so we'll be able to start chaining. So let's keep it as it is. He's got six in the hand, so might as well pass. I think this is one of those. It's not an Entei deck. It's one of those Typhlosion ones where I think they just use Energy Recycler if that's the trainer and try and get a maximum. I think it's 80. For each fire energy. Okay, let's Karina. Surprise! And do you know what? A VS Seeker at this point would be good because I really would like to get another Groudon up and running as quickly as possible. But I'm also thinking ahead. I'm thinking about Battle Compressor. I can actually get two fighting energy in Disc Island and just be ready to go with Primal Groudon. I think that's... at risk of losing this game, I think it's two players who are actually playing Bad Deck Mondays, but never mind. I'm hoping he can't do anything with that Wubfei active. I could get Floatstone. I could... oh, he's playing Skyler as well. I could get Floatstone, and I could Primal Groudon, but I really, really want to get the Battle Compressor. I two Mega Turbos in hand just can't be wasted at all. Wow, that's an aggressive Quilava. I potentially have a fully powered Primal Groudon ready to go. I think he should scoop at this stage, but let's see. Oh, he could waste his time. He could go for the other ground. See, at this moment in time, that would be great. We'd just to have Hawlucha just to retreat, but I can only Mega Turbo one at a time. So Power Compressor, get those two. What I was saying earlier on the video, you've just got to get those two fighting. Don't even think about it. You just got to get those two fighting in the discard as quickly as possible. Now, is there anything that's wasteful? Possibly the Ace Trainer. If I get another VS Seeker, I can start utilizing that. Not really concerned about anything else at this stage. So Typhlosion has potential to knock me out, but we shall see how it goes. I think it's only powered by one fire energy, so he's attaching two. He must be pushed. Oh my gosh. Alright, okay, Flare Destroy. Oh, he's fallen for it! Oh, he must be like, oh, what do I do? Come on. Come on, Groudon, you can do this. Flare destroy, come on. Reading. Yeah, Omega. It's a killer. Oh, right, I've got to risk it. Do I? Yeah, let's go find a stadium. Come on. Guy volcano. Alright, I was really lucky with the stadium. Okay. But it wins. Right, so it's 1-0. And let's roll again. So yeah, lucky with the stadium, but sometimes you've just got to take that risk. Here we go. Potentially Night March? Monetary bats would be right. Actually a really interesting there. So I always think Manectric bats would be favourable. You just have to take care of the Crobat. Ah, look at that. Mystery energy straight there. Oh. Sorry opponent. I'm just reading my own cards. Not ideal. 2 Mega Turbo like that. Okay, so it is Manectric Bats. 2 Mega Turbo. First game we had 2 Mega Turbo in the starting hand. Second game, 2 Mega Turbo in the starting hand. But we get to draw a card. No, let's just leave it as is. Love that mystery energy there now, because it saves, if I had to find a Skylo, it saves me from getting the float stone, and I can then get something else instead. Okay, so he's going for it. 20, 40, 56, 50, maybe with muscle bands, 60. So he's actually going to try and one hit KO my Wobbuffet. I wonder where he'll get to a stage where he can't use Shaman. He has no clue what I'm running. I need to put the Jirachi out. Potentially. Alright, okay, shall we go for it? Thin the deck out first. I hate it when PTCGO does that. Just gives me a little attack. So far so good. I got the Karina. Wow, that was big. That was a big shout there. Now I do have the potential to get 2. Why not? So I've got the VS Seeker in hand, so whatever he overruns, I just start with the other one. Oh! I think he just realised the inevitable. He just was not going to win at all. So again, you know, there you go. Play. We'll try and go for the 5 packs. 3 days to get the AZ. Should be able to do it. Okay, absolute O-0. Don't know whether that's his record. Or hoping that he'll get that many losses. I don't know. Oh, fighting. Another connoisseur. See, I still don't understand how I just got 5 mulligans, 1 turn. Oh, it's a Machamp. Now, these always feature on PTCGO. Machamps are just easy to get. If he's got Fighting EX, he's got Fighting Stadium, that would be interesting as well. Done. He's reading the card. You always get that little pause. Oh, let's just read Groudon. Okay, Lucario. Not too bad for me, because look at my hand. I did have a float stone, but everything else is just... I don't buy Judge at all. I don't buy Judge. Oh my word. That's just insane. Don't buy Judge at all. Okay, so I think it'd be a bit pointless playing Ace Trainer. I've only got one. Could put Pokemon Center Lady in there. That would be a smart move. Focus Sash, Shrine of Memories. Shrine of Memories would be an interesting play later on. Okay, let's leave it at that. The shop has two retreat casts as well. Okay, Hawlucha's there. I hate Hawlucha. Hawlucha is just awful, awful, awful for this deck. What's he got? He's got 2 retreat costs on that. And it's a 2 attack as well, so... Oh, he spent his... spent his Lucario. Oh, he spent his... That's just magic. I'll Lysander up his Machoke and then Mega Evolve, because next turn I can actually get a second Mega Turbo. Or if I get the energy, I can actually get VS Seeker to heal me. He's run out of switch, obviously. Oh wow. Thank you. just want to see what's in my discard pile. Now I play the two Professor Letters, so two Professor Letters. Yeah, I'll get that instead. So at least I have an energy for the next turn. Thin my deck out a little bit. Two Professor Letters are just really, really good in this deck. I hope I didn't attach, by the way. Oh, I just lost track of what I was doing. He's free to bring up the next one if he really wants to. Oh my word, I can actually get the stadium on this. See, at this moment in time, weakness policy down to one and ground on Spirit Link would be tempting. Just to sustain that that chain, but who knows? I mean, massive rend might actually be able to do it anyway. I have thought about a single Ultra Ball as well, but space-wise, Escape Rope might be quite a smart move. No, it wouldn't be. I hope you didn't hear that. Let me just see. Mega Turbo as well. Mega Turbo might do it. No. Alright. Better make a move. Focus Sash might do it as well. But he's just pinging me. That's the thing. Floatstone, perhaps. Yeah, just to save. Pop Floatstone on there. So potentially he's doing Somersault Kick, 120, if he had a strong energy, could sustain a few turns. I'm going to retreat. I need to buy an extra turn just to get that Primal Ground on up. Do dislike those champs. Silent Lab wouldn't be a bad shout. Sycamore. Wonder whether he does play any strong energy. So I could Rip Curl next turn. 30, 50, 70. Yeah, that's... Oh, it's that turn. Skylar for VS Seeker next turn to heal using Pokemon Center Lady, or Lysander. Everything is within range. If I get four prizes, I can get it down to two. Oh, he's fallen for it. And they say, oh, we just want to burn it, that's all. I will get the knockout. I will lose those energies, but... Oh, wow, I just pulled the VS Seeker. No. No, Amiga Barrier. Let me just see. 70. And then... Well, let's just go for that one. Pokemon Center Lady. That's a really interesting one. If I rip claw, does the energy go to Machoke if it's heads? We're gonna find out. Oh, how did I miss out on that? 30, 50, 70. Oh, resistant. Oh, why does it always catch me? Resistance. Skylar Mega Turbo. Oh, he's got the Pokemon Center Lady as well. 20. Oh, that's horrendous, that is. I do have the potential for two prizes. I have to play the weakness policy on... No, I can't. I've got a float stone anyway. I don't know whether I burn. Okay. It's looking as though it's slipping away from me, to be quite honest. I can knock it out, but what does he do? He does 80 next turn. Alright, we'll give it a shot anyway. Come on in. Gaia Volcano. All he needs to do is 120. He's got my spend on there. EXP share. Hmm. MTR. Oh, Hex Maniac might be useful at some stage. Let's put Burgess there. And I don't think we need Weakness Policy. Just keep Birch in there. I don't think we need a Jirachi. So I'm just thinking, as we've got 160, I did put it on there. I don't think I can win this, to be brutally honest. Maniac, he would do 80. No, it's within range now anyway. I'd have to heal. So it's a case of just keep him alive as long as possible. Guy Volcano. Now he has to do 140 damage. We'll do 100. 120 with strong, 140 with fighting stadium if he plays the fighting stadium. Or if he rare candies, he still needs one extra multiplier. Oh my goodness me! We land the game! Just be ostentatious, why not? Just in case there's a... something we've avoided. Bad Scorched Earth. There we go. So, there you go. Three matches on the trot, and just goes to show that it is a it's a really fun deck. It's feel, you know, with Toad being shut down by Vespaquin, inevitably Groudon got shut down, and we just need to show a bit of love to Groudon. So anyhow, thanks for watching. I really, really hope that you experiment with the deck. It's a hugely fun deck. If anyone can get over the grass weakness completely, I don't know, maybe some weird fire Pokemon basic colorless energy is just going to be released that takes fighting energy or something like that, Volcarano or something like that, Volcarona, then please get in touch, and who knows, we might be able to resuscitate Groudon. But for now, thanks for watching. Please leave your comments, suggestions, please like the video. This has been Bad Deck Monday, and Groudon, for now, you are going into back in the binder, and she'll see you guys hopefully very, very soon. So peace, adios, take care. It's Freddy K out.